If the micro is working. It's working. It's a little bit uncomfy, I have to say. I feel like a bodyguard. I'm sorry, my office messed up the lecture. I'm not talking about architecture. I'm talking about the Rolling Stones. The inventors of a new kind of music. let's see. Yeah. Himmelblau was founded in 68, almost 50 years ago. And that makes me very old when I repeat that I was born in 1942. One thing is good in this age, because you have to be very old in order to get to be an architect, I heard. Otto Wagner, a good friend of mine, said, you have to have patience. Only when you are over 60, you start to be an architect. So I'm a very young architect, I have to say. Since then, we were very fond of open societies and open systems. And all the things, all the projects we designed are directed and focused on these two basic topics. Everybody is right, but nothing is correct is one of our topics, and the other is, in only 2 days, tomorrow will be yesterday. You have to consider that if you start to be an architect. Learning is an experience, everything else is just information. That is what Einstein said. I am saying an abstract thought space is just information. Built space, by adding the fourth dimension, time, becomes knowledge and experience. So the question is, what is architecture? A good question. My answer is easy, yes. If we talk about architecture nowadays, we are talking of the peak of an iceberg. We are not talking at all about the invisible architecture, which is the more dangerous part of our profession, namely, think about Andrea Doria or the Titanic. It was crushed not by the visible part, but the invisible part. The invisible part is politics, economy, fashion, whatever. And it's very hard to handle it. Investors, for instance, invisible part. And this invisible part is influencing the visible part a lot. We architects, we're dreaming of being magicians, which can fly. But the reality looks very different. It looks like that. We are squeezed into the laws and regulation and in this invisible architecture at all. So how come? It's easy. This, okay, you understand. If you look at the pyramids, no one doubts that this is real architecture. But look at the program. So if you come to a client today, to the clients who are giving you big, large projects, and tell them, okay, we are doing architecture like pyramids, namely, we are designing a very small program, and the black thing, this is architecture, you will lose the project in 5 seconds. Everyone knows this painting? Yes? Or should I explain what you see? Okay, this is a very famous building. Nowadays, Michelangelo maybe would paint it like that. And actually, this is a dream of our society today. But the reality is this. Namely, Apple. The most closest system I know, you can read that on its new office building. It's a closed system, a donut. Doesn't taste like donuts, but it's a closed system. And this man on the right, on your right side, maybe this is Apple, Mr. Apple, who is directing us. So we are living in a complex world, for sure. Maybe you know it. But what is a complex system? Compare this Stone Age hunter which finds his way along the track of a deer, hunting a deer. Compare it with a guy who tries to find the right gate at the right time for the right flight, which brings you to the right position. If you compare these two guys, Stone Age hunter and a flying passenger, then you know what the complex systems are dealing with. But complex systems trigger complex problems, of course, and complex problems can be triggers complex solutions. Simple solutions, which are understandable. Complex solutions are not so easy to understand. Simple solutions are always old. Complex solutions are always new. Method? Yeah. So how can we deal with complex solutions in architecture? We use drawings, we use space arms, and we use the hand as well, even the model. So all together, and even the 3D scanner, gives us the possibility to create a mixed-use architecture. Not as a program, of a functional program, but as a program for expand or push the envelope of the meaning of architecture. One thing we always dreaming is overcoming of gravity. I'm sure I'm not the only one, and I'm sure since the Gothic architects always dreaming for get rid of the gravity. Since we conquer the space, the outer space, where there is no gravity, we could get rid of thinking only in columns and gravity. And not by chance, I have to say, is the position of the lady lying in the Corbusier's chair the same the astronauts have to take when they overcome gravity. So overcoming gravity in our thinking means that we are the monocentric perspective is for sure obsolete. Architecture 2,500 years ago looked like this. Now it looks like this. So why? Look, the Temple of Paestum, the Doric Temple, need 36 columns in order to lift up the roof. Now we need in the BMW world only 11 columns to lift 10 times the size of the roof of Paestum. I have to say that I don't like columns because a column is a symbol for pressure. I'm going rather for the dynamic tension load in order to make architecture more lively in terms of people should get the feeling of freedom and self-confidence. This is the biggest roof, world record roof we got. But when we built it, we had a lot of problems. While building it, the roof was almost fixed like this. We got new wind codes in Korea. Wind codes which expand the wind wind speed from 200 miles to 280 miles. So what should we do? This was a big problem. Should we dismantle the whole roof, calculate it new, and build a new roof? No. The idea was, look at this red dot here. The idea was, when the wind goes over 200 miles an hour, columns coming up, not tension columns coming up, to fix the roof in order to keep it away from flying away. Roofs, since Niemeyer and Corbie got rid of the roof, the meaning of the roof as a supporting element in architecture, we thought this is a possibility to create by curving the roofs in the inside as well in the outside to get more intimate space, differentiated space, without having walls or columns in this case. Public and private, one of my favorite topic. What is a public and private space? This is both, I would say. Private and public. Empty space. Full space. Another kind of space. It has nothing to do, actually, with open society or open spaces. In all of our projects, we have open public spaces, whether they are used, whether the client allows the public to come in, like in the ECB bank, because of security, of course. We always transplant and implant open space like bubbles, air bubbles in the building. When I was a young architect, my father, he was an architect as well, brought me to the Kunsthistorische Museum in Vienna and showed me the Tower of Babel. And when I asked him, why is this tower not finished? He said, because of an authoritarian guy who hat den Leuten verboten, den Turm fertig zu bauen. And since then, I'm always thinking that the architects of our time should be able to finish this tower. Since this was, when we founded Himmelblau, we really wanted to finish this tower. It was not possible at this time, so we started with a detail of this painting with the cloud. And this is where the name is coming from. This was our first project called Cloud. It was meant to be an apartment building built with air and movable platforms, creating flexible spaces whenever and wherever the people which are living there want to have new spaces. I show you now, in 4 minutes, our complete work. Thank you. It depends on the lecture fee, whether I continue the lecture or not. No, I'm generous. I show you four projects which basically have a political meaning. The first one is the ECB, a bank building. Different meaning, different interpretation. I always think that the EU, European community needs a three-dimensional, symbolic, iconic building, not only iconic graphics. The other one is a museum in Lyon, which has a lot of visitors up to now, 3 million. This is our latest, very small project. And this is the museum in Shenzhen, I'll show you later. This is the ensemble of the ECB. The task was to use an existing, heavily landmarked building and build a high rise next to it as an office building. So we used the high rise to organize the office program, and in the existing building we used as a public and a half public area. But I have to say that since security is one of our main issue in all discussions and in our private life as well, it was very tough to convince people to open the bank people, to open up the hall for the public. So now it's closed, it's heavily secured, and I'm not allowed to show you plans or sections or details because they were afraid of having the same thing like the New York Towers. This is what I wanted to make, to build it in this time, the whole building. That was not possible. It took us longer than from 2003 to 10 years to build it. This is you have to consider that as an architect, that you are wasting a lot of time building buildings. And you don't get good fee, I have to say. What you are doing is making competition, wasting money. I just heard that in Austria they had 4,000 competitors for, I think, 100 competition, 80 competition, they said, in the last 10 years. 4,000 architects were working, and only 80 people could get the projects out of that. So they're using us. They're really using us. We spend 50,000, 60,000 and more for competition, for working on the competition. That means that 4,000 people, that is 200 million euros were wasted. Think about that. I don't want to make competitions anymore. Except we are invited and get the fee for the preliminary design. Then I do everything. Except atomic plants or military buildings. Prisons, I wouldn't do. So this is the program of the ECB in one solid block. Since you can't do that in Europe because of working conditions, light, and so forth, we cut this building in two halves, but we didn't do it in a straightforward cut, but in a curved cut. And therefore, the three-dimensional surface, HP surface, was showing up. But what we did in order to get it solid, we put it together in this way in order to have straightforward circulation elevators and so forth. And we took advantage of this curved HP surfaces because it was easy to build, because an HP surface, as you know, has only straightforward lines. We, of course, we had to explain that to the client because he didn't believe that's easy to build. And he was right. It was not that easy. But we handled it. This is how the building comes to the site. The urban context is, as you can see, only by the visual connection, because it was not possible to build it in the site was outside the core of the city, and in opposite, and I like to do that because this new building will create a new center in Frankfurt, not from now to tomorrow, but maybe in 20 years it will be a new center, and maybe it will grow together, and that makes a city stronger than a monocentric city. The curved outside has many advantages. First of all, it broadens up the view to the north and to the south. And secondly, it helps to make a very efficient energy concept. You have to note that because of this curving the surface, we have sun even in the north, which is very important for the inhabitants and the people who are working there, because everyone wants to sit on the south side. The energy concept. This is craftsmanship. I don't want to refer to that. Building the thing was not that easy than we thought, because as you could see, the one part was a very small on the ground, and the other part is very small on the top, so we had to clamp it together. In what we wanted to do, we want to build a vertical bridge. And that worked. Yeah, sometimes it reminds me on the Tower of the Gothic, negotiating with the gravity. My friend Klaus Bollinger, actually I have to announce him very often, because for every time I say his name, I get a bottle of champagne. So, Bollinger, Bollinger, Bollinger. You are invited. We had to deal with this heavily protected, ugly building. I don't like it because it reminds me on the pre-fascistic architecture in Germany. Anyway, so we had to deal with them, with this, and we had to deal with 8 entrances, which look, as you can see, which look like cat doors. And I have to say that the height of the vertical building has the same dimension of than the Großmarkthalle. It was basically had another function. So we had to deal with the Landmark Society, we had to deal with the city. It was a big deal because we wanted to create an entrance which is showing up. This is a new content, and of course 3,000 people have to walk through the building in order to get to the office towers. So we found out that this Großmarkthalle was destroyed in the Second World War, 1/3 of the hall, and was repaired very ugly. So we could convince the Landmark Society and the city and all the codes and rules, people who made the codes and rules, that if we move the building from here to there, the office building, then we can destroy the existing building because it was not old enough to keep it. So what we did, we moved the building, and then we said, okay, if we put all the program they gave us into the into this Markthalle, then we would not be able to see the old building, which is landmarked so heavily. So we proposed that we took a part of the program out and put it on the roof and create through this new building a new entrance. And the people can at least get a glimpse of the structure of the old building. Of course, we had a lot of discussions because of proportion of the new and the old. You know this game. So we can prove that we, because we are a member of the Preservation Society, we could prove that all our new building, parts of the building are according and referring to the existing Großmarkthalle. And therefore, we could create a new ensemble, old part and the new part, the entrance and the new conference hall on top, inside and on top the building, the atrium. The atrium is divided because of fire police reasons in three parts, every part 60 meters high, so the building is 180 meters high. And this connection between the two parts is actually space for casual information, and people use it extensively. What we proposed as well in order to support the microclimate is a hanging garden like this, but this was not built because the project manager found out it was too expensive. Look at that. The whole building cost 1.2 milliarden euro. This hanging gardens would have cost 2 million. And they said no, because it's too expensive. Look at this. And everyone is talking about green building and energy saving systems and so forth. If it comes to the point, no one wants to have it. The entrance to the bank building, the open public space, which is closed, only the people from the bank can use it because the security is too high. And this the conference center as house in house. And these are the lobbies or the in-between spaces, like cathedrals. Cathedral for money, they say. I think it's a nice space to meet there on the point and to have an overview what's going on. Enemies saying this is wasting money. I say it's good for have an icon in the Eurozone. I like the movies because I don't have to talk about that. This is the connection from the old building to the new. This is the architect explaining the worth of the money. The guy in the black suit and the gray hairs is a partner of mine. He's German, as you can see. Only German architects have black and white. This is the color for the German architects right now. Therefore, they are building houses with windows like in the medieval times, saying this is for energy saving. That's the code of a conservative flashback, I have to say. So one can say that the architects were up to the time right now. In conservative times, we have to build conservative buildings. Like I said, the casual communication point is very important for the whole office space and is used extensively, because if you don't want to be audited by the chief, you can move to the coffee part in these platforms. I'm still dreaming of the hanging gardens. The funny thing is, when we started to design the building, the officials said, okay, put our offices and our meeting rooms, let's say, in the first third of the building. And every time we came back and had this to discuss where the meeting room is, they moved up. So at the very end, their offices and meeting rooms are on top of the building. This is the ceiling articulating in a very special way the European landscape. Musée de Confluence, the most beautiful site. And Jean Nouvel said to me, I'm not envy you because of the project. It was a competition, by the way. He said, but I envy you because of the site. And this is an artificial peninsula. This is the Rhône and the Saône. And this point is called the point of confluence. Therefore, the city called want to have a Musée de Confluence. It is a natural history museum, but this is not a museum, it's rather an event space, because they show not only bones and butterflies, but they make very beautiful exhibitions about toys, the development of toys, the development of the seed, and so forth. The concept was, this was the peninsula, and the site is in between nature, let's say it that way, and the fabric of the city. So we didn't want to block the circulation from the city to the nature. Since we didn't want to block that, we lifted up the exhibition spaces, and you can, through the crystal entrance, you can move through the building or walk underneath the museum to the point of confluence. We designed the landscape as well. This is in the stage, not finished. Now it's green. Everyone likes it because it's green. Don't forget the greenwash if you design nowadays. So the concept was, since it was not a museum, so there are no products. So the spaces for products change into the spaces of knowledge, and therefore there is a lot of changing mutation of form as well. The program model, this is the lifted up exhibition spaces and so forth, entrance. And you can walk through the lobby beneath the museum to the point of confluence. But the trick was, they have several exhibition space, 7, and every exhibition space is connected with the workshop and the material storage. So they can close the the exhibition space is one exhibition space, work on that, and the museum is still open. Yeah, Musée de Conflans, if water comes together, it causes turbulences. And one of these symbols, so to say, is the column in the middle of the lobby, because this column allows us to reduce the steel weight of the whole crystal 1/3, meaning that the budget was diminished 1/3 as well. You can see where this turbulence started from. It's coming from here, going down. So we always argue in a very technical way, program a technical way, in order to defend our idea to create a new language in reception of the space. This is the avenue which leads through the whole museum, coming up from the, you will see it on the movie, coming up, and this is the first floor, this is a glass floor, you can look down to the second level, to the first level, so to say, and these are the entrances to the exhibition spaces. Of course, you can see the point of confluence. The funny thing, and this is it's underneath, it's a landscape. Basically, water, you can walk here. This is a restaurant, of course. The water serves for cooling, because the wind is blowing for cooling the crystal in a natural way. The funny thing was, the mayor was giving an interview 2 weeks before the opening, and the press was firing against the project. They say it was double the budget, it was 10 times more than calculated, and so forth. And he said, okay, that's right, which is not true, I have to say. He said, it's right, and I was always, I was in the jury, I was always against this project. The opening was there. This is very nice that the client, so to say, says I was always against the project. At the opening, there were thousands of people. I think the whole lobby was full, crowded, and the bridge, people were standing on the bridge. It was impossible to get in. And I asked the mayor, what would you say now? And he said, okay, I have to confess that I was against this project, but I did everything in order to build it. 1 month later, when they had 800,000 visitors, he said, oh, this museum was my idea. It's called Espace Lyons. From there, you can walk into the exhibition spaces. And you can see they are doing great exhibitions, which have nothing to do with natural history, but explaining things we don't know yet. You cannot build glass floors anymore because it's pushed in the corner of sexual harassment. Yeah, we are close to the NEPA times. Yeah, in all our buildings we have ramps, stairs, bridges crossing the room in order, since we can't fly until now, in order to experience the space in the three dimension, in the third dimension. The fourth dimension is, which is very important, we forget that. If we only look at the magazines, the fourth dimension is the time we need experience the space in reality, meaning walking through. Some details. This is what I really like. Once I came to the building and saw handprints. Can you see that? Yeah. These are hands, oily hands on this column. And it reminded me on these Lacroix paintings, meaning this is ours. It's a great idea. Building the facade is building like a feather surface. Very ancient method. Two guys were mounting the parts of the facade. I really want to build it in a better way with robots. And this is what I think. The building industry is very stupid, I have to say. If the car industry would think the same way like the building industry, we would still ride on horses. And this was the first idea when we said, okay, we have to convince the client that we can build it much more easier, much more economic when we use robotic systems. We are going to China now. To Dalian. Dalian, this was funny how we get this project. The mayor of Dalian was in Munich, and like every politician which is in Munich, he has to look at the BMW world. And we got a call, and someone said, okay, you have to come to Dalia because our mayor wants to have the same building like in Munich in Dalian. And I said, oh, great. We just have to enlarge our plans. No details, no new details. We take this plan. But when we came there, he said, okay, I like your building, but I want to have a conference hall. And the conference hall, we designed a conference hall. And then he said, oh, you should add an opera building within the conference center. So we started to redesign it. And it was placed on a new island, so to say. And we had to design the shape as well. And this is the concept. This is the city edge. Two boulevards coming together like this. This is the city edge. This is the sea. And we enlarged the land and enlarged the direction of the boulevards. And in this triangle, we placed the conference center with opera. Now it's called cultural center because a whole floor of this 70,000 square meter large building is planned as an exhibition space. Since we had to redesign the whole building because he wants to place an opera building large as the Viennese Opera, we had to redesign it, but we were not allowed to break the building lines. So we pushed the conference center cantilevering out of the building lines. And in between of the conference, we had a lot of public space for coffee shops and so forth. So this is the program, this is how we did it, and this is how we pushed the conference halls through the existing envelope. It's similar to the idea BMW had to make a new solution for a car. And we use these cuts in order to create a so-called climate facade. All these openings serve a very, very important issue. Here you can see the model. Here you can see the Opera building, which takes one-third, more than one-third of the building. These are the conference hall, and this is the public space, the lobby and the public space. The Opera building was very complicated because we have to mix up artificial sound with natural sound for opera and presentation and rock concerts. Sorry. So I have a problem, I can't read it. Please go ahead. I'm wondering how the airplanes are flying, steered by a laptop. Sorry. We are here. Yeah, here. You can see the whole dimension of the building by having the scale done by the people here. The energy concept was we didn't want to have a black box because a black box is always tiring, and a conference hall needs to have not only fresh air but also natural light. That serves the purpose that we can save a lot of energy. And all this seawater cooling and all this climate design is expressed on several parts, very specific parts of the building. Shading, catching energy, guiding the wind through the building, and so forth. This is the building, public space in front. And this is the Opera building. You have to imagine, it's a big Opera building with 3,000 people sitting there. It's a city, actually, I have to say, and 6,000 to 8,000 people are moving through this building when there is a conference and or a cultural event. Going up, going down, crossing the air, I like this building. What we did, because the people were very, very afraid of the metallic interior. So what we did, we painted these light tubes gold. So if the sun is shining, the metal of the inside interior gets very smooth. It's like, it looks like silk. Look at that. This is the Opera building, blah, blah, blah. And the opening was, I was one of 36 politicians, meaning they invited me to be at the opening. It's very seldom, I have to say, that architects are invited for the opening because the politician, the mayor, and all his guys had managed the building, not the architect. And they played a very famous Austrian melody for my opening. I don't know whether you know, it's a military march. I was very happy. The other project in China, which we opened half a year ago, it's an architectural museum. They call it Planning Exhibition and Art Museum. Two museums under one roof, so to say. And since they don't have enough, it's enormous, it's 140,000 square meters. And the exhibition spaces are so enormous that they have not enough material to make a museum out of it, because you will see it's so enormous. Yeah, two museums. This is the art museum. You will see Himmelblau can build boxes as well. And this is the the planning exhibition space. The entrance was directed to the subway station, and in the middle there's a very specific building. We call it Communication Cloud. The idea of the museum was a three-dimensional Chinese garden, because I learned a lot doing museums or galleries by watching Anselm Kiefer, a good friend of mine. He is looking at his paintings or sculptures always from very different angle, from below, from above, from the side. It's very interesting how he is looking at his paintings. He says he needs a different point of view, which is a very good argument for art as well. So this is the maximum volume we had to build, but we turned it around in order to get the entrance looking to the subway station. Then we had to follow, of course, the setbacks. Then we had to follow the dream of the Chinese mayor who wants to... This is the parliament here, the city parliament. And this meant the shape comes from that the dragon is flying through. And we cannot having sharp edges here, so we have to round it. So the mayor was co-designing our building. And in the middle, there is a communication space, cloud, so to say, because there are information spaces and so forth. Where does the shape come from? This is one of my favorite sculptures done by Brancusi 100 years ago. Yeah, an object which is integrated to a base which is speaking a complete different language. And the other thing which I really admire is the moon of the Mars, the Phobos, which circles around the Mars against all calculation around in a different way. It was... And it reminds me of the Viennese tradition, how we are dealing with shapes and curves. This is the development, blah, blah, blah. Of course, you know that, how to do it. So, or when you leave the school, you should know it, how to do it. If not, please visit the office of Patrick. Parapetic knows that very well. And he teaches it very, very, very nicely. Yeah, so this is the outside of the building. You can see these little flags. I like that, how they try to make it visible that this is Chinese and not a crazy European architect. See how we handle boxes? This is the north side, because we don't have to clad it, because it's in the shade. Entrance, entrance, entrance. This is the Museum of Modern Art. This is the inside. It's enormous. I tell you, it's enormous. And this is the cloud. And this is what I meant when I say you have to experience this space by walking through, not only to look at the images. I have to say, when I saw the images, half finished the building, I was very excited when I saw it, realized. It's very friendly because we use different materials against our former code. And the black balconies, the reference to Frank Lloyd Wright, of course, they're planning exhibition spaces, entrance, bridges, walking through. I'm sorry that I cannot show you the real thing here, one-to-one. Maybe you see how large it is if you look at the people on this side. Yeah, this is the architect explaining to the vice mayor of Shenzhen that they need to buy more art in order to fill this museum. Chinese like light and nature. Actually, I know that the, that trees, or I think trees are enemies of architecture. So I said, no landscape architect should touch this area. We will do it by ourselves. It worked out very well. So, and then I thought, when we planned the silver cloud, the communication cloud, I thought about how painful long it took to mount this facade with the old-fashioned method. We proposed to do it with robotic, and we found a company who really designed the whole system. Instead of 80 people working 8 months, they said they need only 8 people for 1 month to build it. The problem was, or is, what should we do with these 72 people? We have to teach them to understand contemporary architecture. Maybe. It's crazy. Rush the whole thing. Christina, can I have 12 minutes of your time? So and so forth and so forth. When we presented that to the client, he was really excited because it was cheaper than handmade things. But then and I was forcing them to do it that way. And I was forcing, and this was a mistake, I was forcing the client so strong that their opponent, the other company who wants to do it with hand, said, I got money from the robotic company that I forced them. So I'm blackmailed. Yeah, yeah, so ungefähr bestochen. So the mayors, this was the time where giving money in order to get the commissions was a very bad thing in China. So they commissioned the other company. So it was made by hand, so to say. Stupid, our times. This is our office. And by using the robots and all the modern methods, maybe our office will look like that in a very, very soon. Very shortly, a little project, not only large project, a little one, 88 meters by 8 meters. A table with a roof was the conceptual idea. But the roof was taken from the, or was created by using the curve of a medieval bone house, Gothic bone house. And by mingling it up, the roof was done like that. Of course, it's a reference to my favorite parts of Corbusier's work, La Tourette with the light tubes and Rochon with the roof. But we did the roof in a different way. It was prefabricated in Germany, transported to a little village, my hometown, so to say, a little village in Austria. It was welded together and a crane put it on top of the table, which was built by in concrete. Stairways to Heaven, music. So, old church tower, new. Yeah, yeah, references. Yeah, look at this Mies building. Wall and roof, how stupid it is connected. Just Corbusier did it in a better way. Look at this, he created a joint by light. So you can read both ways in our building. You can see how Mies turns into Corbusier. And the other thing is that Corbusier did light tubes only ending in the ceiling, but we created a new ceiling by using the shapes. Ah! Okay, I can turn around the laptop. This is nice. Okay, so this is what I... Inside out, even the table was created by the same curve we used from the things. The other small project just finished is a Wunderkammer des Brotes. Wunderkammer, you know, very old thing. Bread is done by the client. The client is a bread factory and he is a crazy collector of things which are connected to bread. And when he came to our office and said, I need a kind of museum where I can expose my collection, I said, after talking and talking to me and showing me the catalog of the products he had collected, I said, you don't need a museum, you need a Wunderkammer. Meaning, a Wunderkammer like this. It's not an art museum, no white walls, and hanging the objects from the ceiling like crocodile here, putting on walls, on the floor, wherever. And he said, okay, do it. And then we started to design it. And then we found out we had not enough space for the objects. We hung it in a vertical exhibition through the eye of the staircase. This is a reference to Catalan, the exhibition I saw the same way he showed in his objects in the MoMA, in the Museum of Modern Art. Everyone says, oh, it looks like a bread. It's not like a bread, it's like a cloud, of course. So don't think that we saw these clouds before. Yeah, it's another story. Looks different from every side. The stair inside is a self-standing, self-supporting object. the hanging garden, the hanging objects. And this is how we found the shape program and so forth, 3D scanner, the coming out of this 3D scan, handmade model, then the analysis of the curves, the visibility analysis, which is very important because we could save a lot of money. We just said, okay, we want to have the facade like shingles, very lively. But this is very expensive, I had to say, since they didn't do it with robots again. So we analyzed where can people see, can't see the surface, and there we made a flat facade. At the visibilities, we made it broken, so to say. And I want to do it in wood. And this was, it's the first self-supporting, free-formed wood construction worldwide, I heard. I don't know. So we made it in wood. This is the way to cut it, the CNC fräse, cut it, blah, blah, blah. We had to calculate all these angles. Yeah, then we bolted together. This is a model of the facade, one-to-one parts. And this is how the inside looked. This is during the construction. You can see. And as I thought when I was there, oh, that looks like a ship, inside of the ship. And I said, okay, it's not a bread. Maybe it's not a cloud. Maybe it's a cloud ship. The Arche Noah, because this is actually the facade, yeah, with all the insulation, and this is the wood, and this is the outside. Yeah, this is my favorite client. He is a really, actually, he is one of my best clients. He was so in love with the building. Can you see that he put away the foley from the metal pieces by hand himself? Have you ever seen your client in the working on your project? Then you can be happy if you see that, because you know he loves it. This is the lecture hall and the stairways winding up, self-supporting. This is the client with exhibition designers. He wants to put the objects, his objects, there by himself. So all this exhibition is done by the client. Of course, we propose to hang his ugly paintings like the Kiesler exhibition. So you can hang a painting on a curved wall, if you use the idea of Kiesler. And this is, of course, natural light sometimes, if the objects are not too expensive. And he has really crazy things. Egyptian mummies, corn mummies. This is beautiful, I have to say. And he explains his objects. The whole ship begins to float. And if you turn the whole thing upside down, which we did, this is design for the Brancusi Museum, which we will build very soon. Thank you very much.
Thank you a lot for the great lecture. Some questions from publicum. Yeah, there, right.
Hello. Thank you for the nice lecture. And I have a question. Is it more fun to build in Europe or is it more fun to build in China?
You mean, is it more fun to build in euro, meaning the fees in euro, or in the
so everything,
or in rim-pim-pim. it's not fun neither here nor in China. Because you have to know if you build big things and you try to be responsible for it, which actually doesn't work in our countries and nor in China. They give you all responsibility, but they take away the power to decide what's going on the side. So this is our faith. Yeah? We are just watching it, and if it's too expensive and takes longer than it was thought, they say, the architect. This is the fault of the architect. So I always think we are like, we architects, we are like sardines in a shark ocean, but we don't have swarm intelligence. Do you understand? I could explain it on a crucial project, on our biggest project. We lost so much money because the project manager took away so many things from us, from the fee, that we lost money. And I insisted to have a golden plaque on the building which says this building was sponsored by Coop Himmelblau. So, no fun, but no pain, no fun. This is what our society says. I say no risk, no fun. Thank you very much.
Thank you again.